Thank you very much. So, as you have said, my name is George Prendo. I'm a research scientist and I'm based at the National Institute for Medical Research in Mwanza. And this afternoon I'm going to share with you a little bit of progress that has been made since the completion of my Thrive-funded postdoc work. At this juncture, I also want to really thank Thrive for giving me the opportunity to come back and meet the Thrive family, hear the science, and share with the audience what how far we've gone. I'd also like to thank my supervisors, Professor Susan Filter from the London School of Integrative Medicine, Professor Dean Toy from the same school, and Dr. John Changalucha, who not only worked with me during the postdoc work, but have continued to provide guidance, support, and advice to ensure that we make progress. So this is the outline of my presentation. I'm going to briefly review my postdoc work and also say a little bit about the follow-up funded project studies, but also highlight the various capacity building activities that are taking place as part of the work that was initially funded by Thrive, and a bit on networking collaborations and future plans. To go back to the background of the postdoc fellowship, studying ones that were conducted between 2006 to 2014 had shown the following. They had shown that people who are undernourished, that is people who have body mass index of less than 18.5, tend to have very severe level of inflammation at the beginning of antiretroviral therapy. But also, this study had shown that both HIV and TB patients regained more adipose tissue rather than lean mass during treatment. So when people with TB come for treatment, about 50% of them are undernourished. And most people, but not all, at least in Tanzania, who started ART are undernourished. But when they started treatment, they regain weight. But the composition of the weight that is regained is more fat and not lean mass. So these observations that were made during those times, and we know that surely these factors, that is regain of adipose tissue rather than lean mass, and the high level of inflammation could increase the risk of people developing NCDs, including diabetes. However, at the time we were making application for this fellowship, there were no many studies that had been conducted in African settings. This slide shows what I have just said, that especially this data is based on New Study Trial, which was a trial that was conducted in Tanzania and Zambia to evaluate the effect of minerals and vitamin supplementation on mortality and other outcomes. But in addition to that, it also, you know, assess the pattern of body weight or body composition recovery. So when we looked at patients who were malnourished at the beginning of ART, we found that at 6 weeks after they had started using ART, they had regained equal amount of what we call lean mass, also known as fat-free mass, and fat mass, which is represented by blue bar. However, by the end of 3 months, there was more fat mass or adipose tissue that was gained compared to lean mass or fat-free mass, indicating that something wrong is happening. We have followed them until 2 years after they had started the treatment and found that this pattern continues, that they tend to have more, they've regained more adipose tissue compared to lean mass. And that was a problem to us. We thought this could increase their risk of developing NCDs, including diabetes. So we applied for a postdoc fellowship which was to assess the prevalence of risk factors for diabetes among patients who were on ART. And the objectives were, first, to assess the prevalence of pre-diabetes, which is a condition that you precede the occurrence of diabetes, and diabetes among HIV-infected patients who were on ART, and to assess if adiposity is a risk factor for pre-diabetes and diabetes, but also to assess if inflammation is a risk factor for pre-diabetes and diabetes among this population group. This study was conducted among 273 individuals. These were people who had been followed up for 2 to 3 years after they had started ART. So at the end of this study, we came with a few key findings. First, we found that the prevalence of combined pre-diabetes and diabetes among HIV-infected patients who had started ART when malnourished, that is when they had BMI of less than 18.5, was very high in Mwanza. That was about 22.3. However, we also found that, and this was not expected, we found that low fat mass at ART initiation, or if you want, if you had a low BMI, very low BMI at ART initiation, and during follow-up, 2 to 3 years after they had started ART, was associated with an increased risk of pre-diabetes and diabetes. This was reverse of what we had expected. We had expected that if you added more adipose tissue, the risk of diabetes would be higher, but we found if you had you had added a lot of fat tissue, then the risk was low. So this was a little bit unexpected. But also we found that baseline and follow-up, that is, we at baseline, I mean, at the time when the trial was started, we did measure level of CRP, which is a proxy for inflammation. And 2 years later, we did the same, but we found that these proxy measures of inflammation were not associated with pre-diabetes and diabetes. No, this finding again was not expected. This data were published or resulted in 2 journal publications, but as you might expect, it led to even more research questions and added to making more applications to be able to come out with the answers that could be conclusive. So as I said, this was good data and formed the basis for later applications to investigate HIV diabetes relationship, but also we knew that there were some limitations. We couldn't really generalize the findings very widely because maybe the sample size was insufficient. We only had 273 individuals, but the study was conducted among population with a high mortality rate. The mortality within 2 years of recruiting this, of starting this patient to ART, was about 40%. So maybe whatever we got was influenced by what we call survival bias, but we did not include HIV and infected group. So we wanted to conduct a study that will take care of the limitations that we found, so that at the end of the day, we come out with the results that we could send to the Ministry of Health and say, this is what we found, could you then translate this into policies? So at the time when we were doing this study, and after we had the initial data, we started thinking ahead and started making applications for later studies. And we were fortunate that in 2016, we got reasonable age funding from the Danish government to do this study, which is titled Diabetes and Associated Complications in HIV Patients. The aim here was to really have a study that will have enough sample size to be able to answer the question that we had asked ourselves at the beginning of post-trial funded postdoc fellowship. But in addition to that, we also recently got a senior fellowship award for EHSP to really further understand the mechanism behind the diabetes among HIV infected people. So I'm going to provide just a brief overview of what we are doing in the Diabetes and Associated Complication in HIV Patient Project, because We are just looking at our baseline data, so I'm just going to give you an overview of what we have. So the main objective is to investigate risk factors for diabetes among HIV-infected patients. And this is a collaborative study. It involves institutions in Tanzania as well as northern institutions. This includes our own institution, Tanzania Commission for Aids and Hinumada Hospital in Dar es Salaam, but also involved the University of Copenhagen, London School of Tropical Medicine, University of Bergen, and University of Vanderbilt in the US. So the specific objective of this study are first to determine the prevalence and incidence of pre-diabetes and diabetes among HIV patients, and to assess risk factors for this condition among this population group. But also we wanted to assess if HIV and ART increase the risk of diabetes and clinical complications and other chronic diseases like kidney disease and hypertension. And we also want to assess if chronic immune activation and the ART deposit increase the risk of pre-diabetes and diabetes among these patients. But importantly, in this one, we also want to characterize insulin resistance and beta cell function and the relationship with the pre-diabetes and diabetes and the duration of ART exposure. Because in the first study, we did not have resources to do insulin studies. So this study is a prospective cohort, but we do baseline and we have 2-1 follow-ups. And we're including participants first who are HIV infected and they have not started ART, but we have a small proportion of participants who are HIV infected and who have started ART. They have used the ART for a medium duration of 5 years. And in addition, we have a group that is HIV infected. But we also including participants who are residents of Mother City, as you would expect, this is a cohort, and those who are willing to be followed up in the next 3 years. So what are we doing? We are collecting data on what you call conventional NCD risk factors, including smoking, alcohol drinking, physical activity using international physical activity questionnaire. So you call this reported physical activity data, obesity, vegetable and food intake. But we're also collecting data on what we call novel risk factors. This includes HIV status itself, ART. So we do collect data on when ART was started, the different regimens that have been used over time, and see whether that will impact the risk of diabetes. But also we collect data on TB treatment history, as well as undernutrition. We also do very detailed anthropometry and body composition measurements, but also we do sample blood for insulin and inflammatory markers, and we do diabetes tests based on three tests, that is HbA1c, fasting plasma glucose, and the oral glucose tolerance test. So at the end of the recruitment period, we managed to recruit nearly 2,000 individuals. We are in the analysis stage. We don't yet have not yet finalized our analysis, but I thought I should share with you what we are getting in this very large sample size. So we are seeing, so these results are based on diabetes. This diabetes prevalence based on the test we call hemoglobin A1c and ODTT, and using HbA1c, we see the prevalence among individuals who are HIV uninfected is 9.3, and the prevalence of those who are HIV infected, not in ART, is 17.7, and among those who are HIV infected and they are on ART is 7.8. Again, using OGTT, the prevalence of diabetes is 4% among those who are HIV negative, and it is 8.1% among patients who are HIV infected, not on ART, and only 3.3 among those who are HIV infected and on ART. This is just a highlight of what we are trying to see, or what we've seen. This is the here we are showing the risk factors for diabetes based on using HbA1c tests, and compared it to individuals who are HIV uninfected. Those who are HIV infected, not on ART, they have like twice the risk of being diagnosed with diabetes. While those who are on ART, they seem to have similar risk as those who are not HIV infected. But of importance is that even though we use the reported physical activity questionnaire, we found that people who report to have adequate levels of physical activity are at reduced risk of being diagnosed with HIV, with diabetes. Sorry. We see the same trend when we use when diabetes is diagnosed using OGTT, the same picture. We have also collected data, as I said, insulin data, and we use those data to determine insulin functions, beta cell function, and insulin resistance. But these results are based on insulin levels that are determined at fasting. When patient came for diabetes test 30 minutes later and 120 minutes late. And these represent patients who are HIV uninfected. These are patients who are HIV infected but not on ART, and these HIV infected on ART. What we see here, this difference of significance, compared to patients who are HIV negative, which are represented by the blue line, those on if HIV infected and on ART have lower levels of insulin secretion at 2 hours. So although the prevalence is the same, the risk prevalence is the same as those who are HIV infected, but they seem to secrete levels of insulin, we are still looking at this data, but maybe they are in a worse situation than those who have not studied ART. So let's move directly to the capacity building activity that we are doing as part of these projects. So as part of this project, I have supervised one postdoc, and he has done a project that is comparing the three tests among HIV infected and uninfected patients, and this received funding from NIH for that fellowship program. But also as part of these projects, we have three ongoing PhD projects. The first one is looking at the impact of physical activity, which is determined or assessed using objective measurements. It's not determined using the physical activity questionnaire. This is objective measurement using accelerometry. So the impact of that on diabetes among HIV infected and HIV infected Tanzanian adults. And the second one is looking at cardiovascular disease risk in HIV infected patients. And the third one, a more recent one, which is receiving some support from EDSP, will be looking at the artery patterns, enteropathy, and diabetes in Tanzania. But also, as part of these ongoing projects, we supervising for fellowships or career development awards, and the one is looking at the validity of HbA1c in diagnosing diabetes among patients with hemoglobinopathies in Tanzania. The place where we are based, that is northwestern Tanzania, in that place the prevalence of hemoglobinopathies, including sickle cell, is very high. We want to see whether HbA1c testing is doing a good job, West Montgomery is not doing a good job. But also, there is another fellowship project that is comparing, it's doing a comparison of subjective and objective measurement of physical activity among HIV infected and HIV infected in Tanzania, and another one on HIV status disclosure linked to care, and yet another one on gut microbiome, HIV, and diabetes, which is being funded by University of Copenhagen. So what has happened over these 3 years in terms of networking? So over the 3 years, we have strengthened existing collaborations. Yes, we were collaborating with the with the people at the school, but the 3 years have seen this collaboration being strengthened. But we have managed to also get new collaborators along the way. So in summary, the work that was funded by Thrive resulted in 2 journal publications, 2 funded grants, 8 students being mentored. But also, importantly, it has led to what I think is a group within NIMRI that is now doing research on the interaction between infections, particularly HIV and NCDs. Before the Thrive Postdoc Fellowship, this group did not exist. Now we have a group of 4 people that I would say they are focused on daily basis to do research on the interaction of diabetes or and the HIV or NCDs and the infectious disease. But like I said, this has also strengthened the collaboration. So what do we plan to do in future? A lot of plans that that we have. So we plan to continue doing work on diabetes risk factors, and that would include what we already do, but also we extend it to see what gut microbiome and HIV does to increase the risk of diabetes. We also want to do metabolomics and HIV and diabetes, but we also want to expand our research on diagnosis of diabetes. But we also like to do research to see the long-term health of patients that we are seeing. That what happens after 5 years, after 10 years, when people have started ART. We would also like to do that. But we also think that it will be important to think of designing interventions that would help reduce the risk of diabetes among individuals who have HIV. With all these plans, we have a dream that one day we are going to have a center of excellence in the infections and STD research in NIMRI Mwanza Center. So lastly, I would like to acknowledge different organizations for different things they have done over these years. Firstly, Thrive for funding. Without Thrive, we wouldn't be where we are. But also like to thank Danida, NIH Forward Global Health Fellowship Program, and EDCP. I would also like to thank the National Institute for Medical Research for providing leadership. Particularly, I would like to thank Dr. Judy Chamalucha, who has done a lot to ensure that this work goes on, and the current director of NIMRI Mwanza, Dr. Spike Kinonge. At the school, I would like to thank Professor Susan Filter and Jim Todd, and University of Copenhagen. I would like to thank Professor Eric Fries. But we're also working with Professor Paul Kelly, who is at Queen Mary University of London, in the new EDCP funded projects. And we also like to thank colleagues at the University of Flanagan. Thank you very much.